One of the great conceptual visionaries in modern speculative science has been the late Freeman Dyson, who passed away in 2020 at the age of 96. Dyson had many interesting ideas, such as the Dyson Swarm of energy collectors, though he himself pointed out that a full-on Dyson sphere only bears his name popularly, and that the concept for that is far older, going back to science fiction author Olaf Stapledon in his 1937 novel Star Maker. The difference, of course, is that a full-on enclosed Dyson sphere comes with massive engineering and stability problems, and while a very limited form of it is just barely technically possible, it's not practical. A Dyson swarm, however, is so eminently possible that we're already building one, with our array of active and defunct spacecraft in solar orbit. That's where such things start. They had their solar panels and used the sun's energy to transmit back to Earth. Scale that up and you've got a civilization with a functioning energy collection system that can harvest most of the power of a star. Dyson had other ideas, such as Dyson's sunflowers, where he envisioned life beginning inside of the ocean of an ice shell moon, and evolving to grow up through the cracks in the ice like a plant in order to reach the sun. He envisioned them as superplants that might incorporate natural mirrors for heat and energy. He even wondered if such a species could evolve to leave its ice shell moon and colonize asteroids. But Dyson also had more obscure ideas, and one of those has to deal with civilizations organized on the Kardashev scale. How that famous scale came about was when Russian astronomer Nikolai Kardashev had the idea of classifying civilizations based on their energy usage. It's very simple. A type 1 can utilize the energy potential of their planet. A type 2 can use that of a star. And type 3 can use that of an entire galaxy. As many have pointed out over the years, this may be too broad of a brush. In fairness, Kardashev was just doing a thought experiment. And you have to start somewhere when trying to classify something that you've never seen, such as alien technological civilizations operating on large scales. All we know is our own civilization, and it doesn't even rank as a type 1 yet, though it's getting closer by the day. What we know is this: we have never seen good evidence of any of the three types of civilization on the scale. There are many reasons for why this could be, which are the Fermi paradox solutions. One very simple answer is that no examples of any type of Kardashev-ranking civilization exist, because such things do not make practical sense, and that the reality of technological civilizations is far more subtle and situational. Or, if you will, we don't see Kardashev Type 3 civilizations controlling the power of their entire galaxy because they don't need that much energy to run their civilization. Take, for example, a very alien civilization, at least to our eyes, that only has a population of 100. Maybe they live an exceedingly long time, and reproduction cycles for them are such that they never really change much in population numbers, especially if they are artificial. Or they simply limit their population. What would such a civilization do with a galaxy containing 100 billion stars? It's hard to see too many ways they could or would even need to do that. Even our civilization obeys this. Yeah, we have around 8 billion people on Earth, but the Milky Way has over, perhaps very significantly over, 100 billion stars. So everyone living on Earth right now could colonize a star system, and we still couldn't claim to be a Kardashev Type 3. Because there aren't enough of us to physically do it in the entire galaxy, at least in person. It's worth noting there, though, that a machine civilization could very easily reach those numbers, and indeed, there are practically no upper limits on population for future humans that spans the entire galaxy, not for many trillions of years anyway. But we do not have those numbers yet, which is a little disconcerting to envision. There does come a time when the stars start blinking out, and the time of megapopulations and galactic civilizations ends. At some point, you end up with a remnant of that population turning out the lights and heading into oblivion, because the universe has run out of energy. I'm glad to live in a time that is nowhere close to the effective end of the universe. Interestingly, there is another aspect to the Kardashev scale. Once you hit type 1, which we probably will do within the next few hundred years, then moving to type 2 might happen relatively rapidly. Dyson estimated only about 2,500 years. However, getting to type 3 might take several million years because of the space travel involved and the speed of light limit. There is also an interesting effect hidden within type 2 civilizations, something that has not been well fleshed out by SETI but championed by Dyson. So if you're harnessing the power of your star, there's one thing that you can't do, and that is break the second law of thermodynamics, meaning that such a civilization would produce a huge amount of waste heat at 10 microns in infrared. Dyson suggested that a survey of infrared sources at around that frequency should be done, and then targeted radio searches done on the candidates, since any type 2 civilization by definition must produce this kind of 10 micron emission. There's no point in looking at stars that do not exhibit this emission if your goal is to catch a type 2. Not so for type 1. They would be on our level, and one of the few ways to detect civilizations on that level is radio. Type 3 would be obvious, and we haven't seen one. Nor does the Milky Way show anything but natural, unaltered stars. That's one thing we can say. There is no type 3 in this galaxy, but there may be an equivalent. When we think of a standard type 3 civilization, we tend to think in terms of technology. We think of them encasing their stars in Dyson swarms, or spheres, and maintaining a highly technological existence. But Dyson proposed that this may not be the case. It's also possible that mature biotechnology might be the route aliens take. Dyson's idea was that advanced type 3 civilizations may not choose to live on planets at all, but rather comets covered in genetically engineered trees that could generate energy. He also specifically mentioned what he called black asteroids as a source for carbonaceous chondrite meteorites. These carbon-rich meteorites could in principle be used as a growing medium. He also advanced the idea that a genetically modified plant can be made to grow its own greenhouse. The universe, of course, is likely to host untold numbers of asteroids and comets, significantly more than stars and planets add up to. That might make them more attractive platforms for Type 3 civilizations. But also Type 2 is a basis to either mine for materials to build energy collectors for a Dyson swarm, or to outright colonize, as opposed to the other planets of their star system. It's worth noting that standing on the surface of an asteroid is more or less the same as floating in space. As long as you have a spacesuit, it's not anywhere near as harsh as it would be to stand on the surface of Venus. We will colonize asteroids in the future and mine them, but we are not likely to ever mine the surface of Venus, at least until we are so advanced as to be able to terraform it. But it may never be worth it. Growing plants in a greenhouse, suspended by balloon in the relatively clement upper atmosphere of Venus is much easier to do. And that brings us back to questions of practicality for Type 3 civilizations. Yes, collecting the energy of stars makes sense for stars like the Sun. But when you start getting to larger stars, it makes less sense because they get shorter lived and tend towards exploding in supernovae. That actually is an obscure technosignature, that of red spirals. One thing a Type 3 might do is kick out dangerous stars from the galaxy, favoring only smaller, more manageable stars. Known as red spirals, this type of galaxy would show a profile of light that would be unnaturally reddened in comparison to a normal galaxy. The problem is that old galaxies redden as they age. So searching for red spirals is a matter of looking relatively close by, because the more distant a galaxy, the more we see it, as it was in the past. And there comes a limit where it's not likely for a Type 3 civilization to have existed at that time in that galaxy. It's also a matter of keeping track of the age of galaxies. If its evolution seems to be in a state where it isn't old enough to redden, then the technosignature comes on the table as a possibility. And there is yet another possibility regarding Kardashev Type 3 and what they might look like. Actually, several, and they depend on the advanced civilization going in a different direction than what Kardashev described. another would be a nanotechnological civilization, uploading itself into a cloud of nanotechnology, functioning as a cloud computer. This would take the form of a cloud or clouds, even pervading the galaxy, that would be distinguished from a dark nebula from the materials it was made of. And then there is the possibility that Kardashev Type 2 civilizations crack how to create a new universe, and leave this one before they ever transition to Type 3. One does not need the power of a galaxy when you can have the power of a universe, and in the end, we do not understand all of physics. But someday we will, and perhaps the colonization of a galaxy falls to the wayside, and all civilizations that reach that level of development simply develop better universes that never end. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently worried about the universe again. If all the good civilizations create splinter universes to move to, then what if Type 3 civilizations that do not leave it, but choose to remain stealthy, or all Type 3s remain stealthy? The spooky possibility in that is asking, if they are all powerful, why do they need stealth? And that is the subject of my new upcoming book out in 2026. And be sure to check out my other books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.